Aha, this will be fun. So I don't know why I always feel like I have to do this, but there's so many reasons why I have become so obsessed with plants. I mean, almost everybody probably already knows by now, in our sort of knowledge acquisition story, when we first started learning about medicine, I didn't even really want to. I didn't want to learn about plants. I was like, I didn't even really know what was happening. I was just listening to my grandma talking about really cool stories. And it wasn't until I started going out and harvesting all of this different kinds of medicine that I started to kind of piece together what their names were in the language, their Anishinaabe names. And when I would be picking them, when I'd be spending time with them, because it's literally like you're out there with the same plant all day long. Everybody always knows when you're doing a task, when you're doing something all day long, the same repetitive thing. When we go out and pick medicine, we usually spend a whole day or a couple days getting one plant. And so you're going through the forest and your eyes are only looking for this one certain shape and shade and structure. And so that's all you're looking for. So already at the forefront of your mind the entire day, just looking for it, all you're picturing is that plant. Then when you're picking it, of course, you're just involved in that task and all you're doing is picking that medicine. And, you know, every time you close your eyes, that's all you could see. Like, you know, sometimes you close your eyes and there's nothing there. But when you're busy doing something all day, repetitive task, and then you close your eyes and then all you could see is that plant. And it's like, oh, man, you're going to bed at night and that's all you could see. And then in your dreams, that's all that happens in your dreams is you pick that medicine. And then you get up the next day and you do it all over again. And you do that for 3 days. You spend so much time with that plant. You develop such an intimate familiarity with that species. From the way that it smells to the way that it feels when you're touching it, the taste of it, the types of dirt that it's growing in, the relationships around it. It's so fascinating to be able to understand a plant to such a great degree. And then to know what its Anishinaabe name is, I started to kind of realize that, man, well, all of these names of Anishinaabe names of plants really do a good job of capturing the identity or essence of that plant, something that seems to be like embedded in its design. The name captures it so well. And so a few of these examples I get of different plants, they have really unusual. Okay, so this catches me off guard a little bit because generally I approach everything really, really critically. I never just, it doesn't matter if this is coming from my wife or my grandma or my mom or my daughter or a scientist that's been the top in their field for 30 years. It doesn't matter who I'm listening to. I approach and read and understand everything extremely critically. From the get-go. And it's through the validity of that work that criticism is alleviated. It's pretty harsh, I guess, sometimes can lead to harshness. But one of the things that always catches me off guard is when a plant has such a simple name, like this one right here is, they're called Bellwort, Uvularia grandiflora. Yeah. Okay. So I almost said laterifolia, whatever. Uvularia grandifolia, which is a big flower. I guess that's what that's talking about, the Latin name. But these are super interesting to me because they're a super common spring ephemeral. So this is one of my favorite times of year in the spring when everything is first starting to come up. You get a really clear picture as to like those plants that are so robust that they could flower, make flowers when it's below freezing at night. Lots of them blooms are coming out when there's still snow on the ground. Like these are really incredibly resilient plants. Some plants, they even melt the snow around the bud so that the bud is able to bloom while there's still snow on the ground purposefully, like skunk cabbage. It's crazy. This springtime is a time I feel when plants really show how strong that they can be. And yeah, the idea that the time is ephemeral, like these plants come and go really, really quickly, is also really exciting to be able to catch all of the ephemerals that year kind of thing. But this one, really, really powerful spring ephemeral, Bellwort, Uvularia grandifolia, is super interesting to me because in the Shnabe language we call it Waapshkijiibik. And I was always like, man, I don't know. Because like Waapshke means white, right? And Jibik or Jipkan is a root. So Waapshkijiibik is white root. And I'm always listening to people talking about these names of plants. And I'm always like, you know, approaching it with a certain amount of criticism. Like, surely there's other white roots out there. Why is this one white root? And it's just so fascinating because legit is the only white roots that we have in this part of the Great Lakes, like where I'm from on Manitoulin Island. This is Waapshkijiibik. We also have Waapshkijiipkenhs, which would be the closed gentian or bottled gentian. It has purple flower top, really, really bright, pearly white roots, but generally they're really small. On Manitoulin anyways, they're very, very small. When you go a little bit more into the northern range of that plant, you get you get closed gentian, the gentiana andrewsi will have a little bit bigger roots, and they will call it Waapshkijiibik there. So it's really the only plant that deserves that name. And one of the reasons why it deserves that name is because when it's dried and stored, it's still one of the only white roots that you're going to have sitting on the counter or sitting in the shelf. And so it maintains that identity. And that is truly one of the things that makes it separate, makes it distinct. What makes this plant unique, that's a feature that separates it from all of the other plants that are around it, which is interesting to think about because that is the reason why we have scientific taxonomy. That's why we have the Latin names of plants that are looking at one feature of that plant that is distinct, that no other species is going to have. The whole design of scientific taxonomy of plants is to make sure that you're giving this plant a name. That name is describing a feature that that particular species has that no other species on the planet can have. It's only designed to ensure positive identification. And you see that with Anishinaabe names of plants too. But it seems so arbitrary at first to call something white root. There's so many white roots that we have. This one is the only one that keeps it. Keeps that white color when it's stored on the shelf and you're sitting in the middle of winter looking at your stash. This is the only white root that's going to be there, which is pretty interesting. How something that seems arbitrary can still, you know, become and still maintain that the definition of that species. So it's really interesting to see the power that indigenous taxonomy of plants can have, kind of sneakishly, I guess, because I always tried to critique it, but it just holds up, it stands up, it holds true to that criticism, and it is really the only white root that we have that stays white kind of no matter what. And so, yeah, Bellwort, Waapshkijiibik, Uvularia grandiflora. This is a really incredible plant that shows us that sometimes, I guess, the Anishinaabe taxonomy of plants can be compared to the scientific taxonomy of plants. This really brings to light a really, really interesting perspective as to, like, the scientific taxonomy of plants will only gesture to the aerial components, parts of the plant that you can see, nothing underground, because that is never engaged with. As a traditional herbalist or botanist, the roots are generally never touched, because it's just the, you know, for scientific inquiry to be able to learn more about the plant, you would have to be able to uproot it and have the roots be a part of that analysis, but that destroys you're killing the plant. And so generally in the scientific community, using or utilizing roots in taxonomy is not there. And most botanists, most people who study plants have no idea what the roots look like, or what the roots smell like, or what they taste like. And that's one of the things that you'll hear or see often in indigenous taxonomy, is all parts of the plant are understood and utilized in that opportunity to name something or in the taxonomy of that species. The distinct or separative features of that plant include all parts of the plant. So yeah, lots of real cool stuff to think about. Like when we go through this process of taxonomy and the naming of plants in the Shnabe language, this one really shows our intimate familiarity with every single one of these plants to be able to identify a feature that a plant has that no other plant has can have. These Waapshkijiibik, Waapshkijiipkenhs, these white roots of Bellwort, Uvularia, grandiflora. But yeah, I really, really love this plant, and it's such a pleasure to go and enjoy. Holy man, when everything is just first starting to come up, first thing in the spring, still frost in the morning, still little bits of snow on the ground, it pops up, and it's like this really delicate looking, soft, really, really beautiful flower in such harsh conditions. So it's really nice to be able to see that power of spring ephemerals. Something I get so hooked on every single year. And just, yeah, got to catch a couple pictures of. it's a really good one. Chumigach, mbama.